who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory. Who shakes the whole world with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place. Lay down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations? Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hallelujah!
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. And I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Sing it again, listen.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be saved. Jesus, I sing for.
Come on, we need to sing that one more time.
This is amazing grace.
We thank you for your amazing grace.
This is unfair.
You are worthy to be praised. Hallelujah.
If you would take my place, then you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hallelujah. Come on, lift your voice and shout unto the Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. Hallelujah. Come on, greet your neighbor right now. To your right, to your left, and then you may be seated.
What makes your mom happy?
Flowers, when I listen.
When I be good or something?
I don't know, that's too tight.
What makes your mom sad?
When I don't listen.
Oh, like when we get hurt.
What's something that your mom does every day?
Read the Bible, cleans the house,
and I think work.
Kisses me.
What's something your mom always says to you?
I love you. And brush my teeth.
Go clean your room.
Behave.
Don't let the dog upstairs.
Do not bother mom while she's sleeping.
How old is your mom?
I think 5.
12.
That's a very, very tricky question.
I know she's a half and something.
70.
What's your mom's favorite thing to do?
Play with me.
Sit in that chair.
Date night.
Shop.
Shopping.
Go shopping.
It's just shopping every day. She always wants to go shopping.
Me and I get tired. Then that's kind of boring.
Where's your mom's favorite place to go?
Chinese restaurant.
An animal shelter.
I think it's to the mall.
Go to the restroom.
How are you and your mom the same?
Our hair.
Our eyes.
We have the same phones.
We're really flexible.
We both have long tongues, but my sister and my dad don't really.
How are you and your mom different?
Our eyes are different.
The color of me. I'm brown and she's tan.
Mom has curly hair and I have straight hair.
I do have better abs.
What's your favorite thing about your mom?
That she doesn't like to be away from us.
When she gets down the floor and plays with me.
She's a really good teacher.
I like her face.
Her smile.
When she lets me put on her makeup.
That I can cuddle with her at night.
She is really special.
She's really, 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 really nice.
How do you know that your mom loves you?
She prays and she kisses me and she says, I love you.
Because she's in my family.
How she takes care of us.
By making breakfast.
Do my laundry.
That she helps me get dressed.
Takes me to all the things I do after school.
That she plays games with me.
Play soccer with me.
Play bubbles.
When I sit in her lap.
We watch movies.
We get our nails painted.
Make a scrapbook.
Fish.
Outside cookouts and bonfires.
She spends time with us and not all by herself.
She's patient. With us.
She does everything with me.
Because she says it every day.
Kisses me every night.
And all kinds of stuff.
I just know that she loves me because she says, I'll always love you.
She's awesome.
She loves me no matter what. Like God.
I love you, Mommy. Happy Mother's Day.
Let's all stand.
Singing hallelujah.
broken, eyes have been opened, an army of dry bones is starting to rise. Death is defeated, we are victorious, for you are alive. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Make his praise so glorious, glorious, glorious. For his name is glorious, glorious, glorious. We'll shout his name so glorious, glorious. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. Make his praise so glorious, glorious, glorious. For his name is glorious, glorious, glorious. For his name is glorious, glorious. Glorious, glorious,
Cheryl, she has a few announcements to make. You may be seated.
Good morning, everyone. Morning. Welcome to Fire and Water. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. We have a special presentation for all of you in just a little bit, so hang on. Let's take the offering at this time. Let's get ready to continue to worship God right now with our tithes and offerings, giving back to Him just a portion of what He's given us. He's given us a lot, hasn't He? Yes, we worship Him this morning. So if I could have the ushers come forward, and we'll get ready to take the offering right now. Give you a little time to get your offering ready. I'll go ahead and make one announcement while you're doing that. This Friday is our monthly Women Reaching Women meeting. And our theme this month is Hats Off to Mothers. And we're going to have a great time. We're going to set up a banquet hall in here in the sanctuary. And we're asking all of you to come and wear a hat. Get creative. We're going to have a contest on the most creative hat, the most unique hat, and the prettiest hat. So go crazy. I've heard a lot of you talking about what you're going to do, and it sounds like a lot of fun. So we're going to have a hat parade, and then we're going to vote on the hats that we think are the most special. Bring somebody with you. Bring a mother. We're honoring mothers, so you don't have to be a mother to come. We all have mothers, and we all know mothers. So bring somebody with you, even if you're single or your mother's not in town. Invite somebody at work that would love to come and just have a good time with women. We're going to have dinner in here, and we're also going to have a photo booth out in the bookstore set up, and my daughter and her husband are actually coming to take photos, and we've got some crazy things you can put on, or you can have a picture taken with your friend in your hat, or it's going to be a fun evening. It's going to be a really fun evening, so I want to encourage all of you to come out 6:30 on Friday night. You ready to take the offering? Okay. Isaac, do you want to pray?
Heavenly Father, we come before you thanking you for all the goodness that you have done in our lives, Lord. Right from the day we were born, Lord. Rather, right from the day we were conceived, Lord, to this day, you have been faithful to us, Lord. And whatever you have given us, Lord, we want to bless you back, Lord, with whatever we have, Lord. Yes, Lord, we just want to say thank you in our own little way, Lord. Yes, Lord, for you are a great God. You are a wonderful God. You are a mighty God. Oh, you are a powerful God. You have great plans for our lives, Lord, and we want to bless you, Lord. Oh, because we love you, Lord, for all that you have done in our lives, Lord. Bless each and everyone who is giving, Lord, and use it for your kingdom glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise God. One other thing I wanted to say, if you didn't get a flyer for Friday night, I think there's some out in the bookstore, but we're also going to be blessing the Steps of Faith Hope Women's Center in Phoenix. And I encourage all of you to bring some non-perishable items. There's a list on the back of things we're collecting for them that night. And we'll have a little presentation, a 5-minute presentation about their ministry that night. So please participate in that also. Our neighborhood outreach is Saturday, May 25th at 10 o'clock. So I know last month we had a lot of people. I don't know how many we had, 200? Yeah, there were a lot of people here. So, you know, let's do it again. Everybody come out this month and let's go out and reach the neighborhood. And Saturday, May 31st, is our next water baptism service at 7 o'clock. So if you've just recently gotten saved or you're new to the church and you've never been baptized, this is a great opportunity for you to get baptized. Baptism doesn't save you. Jesus does. But this is a way for you to publicly acknowledge what God has done for you. So there's a sign-up sheet in the bookstore. Make yourselves available to that. Also, just a reminder that we are on a 31-day corporate fast here at the church. And if you have not picked up a calendar, there's one out in the bookstore on the counter. And please, you know, pick up a calendar. If you can only fast one day a week, it doesn't matter. If you can only fast one meal, whatever you do before God, whatever you bring before God and make a commitment to do, just keep your commitment and then pray for whatever is in the box on that day of the month that you're going to fast and pray. We're believing God to do mighty things when this fast is over. Amen? So we need everybody to participate, and let's just watch and see what God's going to do. Praise God.
Are you guys sure you've got this?
Yeah. The twins are plugged in. Baby's asleep. How hard can this get?
We're men. Besides, I bumped into Chuck Norris at a Pizza Hut once. I think his power's rubbed off on me.
Get out of here. Go on, enjoy your mommy getaway weekend.
Oh, this weekend was a bad idea.
Do you remember what happened last time we watched the kids?
I'm not a piñata!
Get it off me! Get it off me!
Yeah, we're gonna need help.
Use of this product may alter your perception of reality. All right, everything looks the same. This is a joke.
Guys, it's like the Sahara in this cup. Can somebody hit me with some juice? And listen, pulp, no pulp, doesn't make a difference to me. You're the ones dealing with the diaper.
Mom goggles!
It's beautiful!
Okay, sweetie, I need you to sit on your bottom. Listen to Daddy. You sit on your bottom, okay? Daddy's gonna come get you. Don't move. Don't dance. Just sit on your bottom. Okay? Daddy's gonna come get you.
Whoa! Don't you try to stop me.
Baby made a poopy, yes you did.
Where are your mom goggles?
They wouldn't fit over my hazmat suit.
Take this.
Oh, oh. So cute, baby.
And then the little boy, he rocked his mommy. Oh, I love you. Forever, I like you too.
I don't know how they do it.
Oh, well, you take it and you fold it from corner to corner.
No, I'm asking the question, how do moms do all of this? How do they handle it all?
Well, maybe they have goggles we don't know about.
It's as if God gave moms a special way of looking at things, you know? Okay, who taught you servanthood? Who modeled grace? Who gave you a taste of what God's love could look like?
My mom, Mr. T, and my mom.
Anyway, I just think God gave moms a special way of looking at things. Hey, honey.
Hey, how's it going at home?
It's all good. Guess you could say I'm starting to catch a glimpse of what your world looks like.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Mama.
Hold on, your daughter wants to say something to you.
I did, Mama.
She says she misses you. And she realizes how important you are in her life. And she doesn't know how you do it. And she knows that she can't make it without you.
She said all that, huh?
I don't know if she said it. But it's what I wanted to say. And I should have said it a lot sooner. I thank God for you.
The twins.
It was nothing. We have to go, okay? Love you, Mommy.
Are you guys sure you got this?
Well, like I said, we have something special for all the moms in the house today. And, you know, it's Mother's Day, but we should be honoring our mothers every day. As you just saw in the video, all the things they do for us and all the teaching and training and prayers and everything that comes out of a mother's heart, we need to be thankful. And so I want to encourage you to love on your mom every day of the year, not just on Mother's Day, okay? Before we start today, I want to give this to the mother of this house. Mama Bessie. She's all of our spiritual moms, isn't she? Thank you. I just want to honor you today. And I'm sure she's glad to have her daughter, Stacy, here with her to celebrate Mother's Day. Also, I want to send a couple of roses back to Paula and Joan. I saw that they're here today. I'll give you some yellow ones. Happy Mother's Day. I think Joan is, what, is she 101 now? Yes. You believe it? It's awesome. Come on out. So what we're going to do right now is have all the moms, if you would come down this aisle over here, and then we'll have you come across the stage. We're going to give you a flower, and then you can go down this way. And this is just our way of saying Happy Mother's Day to all of you here at Fire and Water.
Thank you. singing, you make. You make.
Did we get everybody? Let's just give all the moms a hand. Amen. Praise God. We honor you, mothers. We honor you today. And God, I just pray right now a blessing over every mother in this house. God, I thank you that this year, this next year, would just be a year of abundance for them in every area of their life. God, bless them spiritually, emotionally, mentally, physically. Financially, God, I just pray that blessings would pour out to them for everything that they've sown into their children, God. And I just thank you, Father, that you would lead them and guide them by your Holy Spirit, that you would do wonders in this next year, that you would do miracles in their lives, God, that you would bring healing and deliverance where it is needed, God. And I thank you for restoration of families right now, Father, for those whose children are prodigals and are away from you, God. We call them in right now by your Holy Spirit. We call them in from the north, the south, the east, and the west. And God, you are in the family business. You are in the business of restoring families and restoring relationships, God. And we just declare restoration right now in every family in this church, right? In the name of Jesus, we declare that it will be done in Jesus' name. We're going to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise in Jesus' name.
Let's all stand. I see the King of Glory.
Coming on the clouds.
Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
Hallelujah. Come on, just worship Him for a moment. Just thank Him today. Hallelujah. We thank You, Lord, for Your goodness. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship You, oh God. Oh, we worship You, oh God. Have Your way. Have Your way, Lord. Hosanna. Hosanna. Come on, just lift your voices and worship. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship You, God. We worship You, God. Oh, let Your praise arise. Let our praise arise. Let our worship reach You, God. Let our worship reach to the throne, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, we worship You, oh God. We worship You. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. Holy is Your name. Exalt Your name, You're worthy, God. Oh, we honor You, we praise You, God. Holy glory and honor to You. Glory and honor to You. God, oh Jesus, hallelujah, my healer, oh my provider, deliverer, oh You're my everything, God, You're my everything, Lord, You're all I need, Lord, You're all I need, Lord, oh You're all I need. Guest speaker here. I just want to welcome Pastor Gus's sister, Stacy. Let's give her a hand.
Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I am so excited to be here this morning. The Lord has totally blessed me, gave me the opportunity to be here with my mom. Of course, I came out because my brother had surgery, so I've been his nurse for a week. Yes, I do need prayer, yes. but anyway, I am thankful to be here. My husband said that it was raining and snowing in Colorado, and it was in the 20s last night. So yes, I am very thankful to be here this morning. Well, it is my honor this morning to introduce our next speaker. He is a man of God, a man of integrity. He has personally blessed me, took time out of his busy schedule to visit me in the hospital when I was sick. He's always available when my brother needs something, just willing and able and ready. He even came to Grand Junction and preached at my church. So anybody that does that, God bless you. So please help me welcome Pastor Saeed.
Thank you.
Good morning, good morning. That sounds much better. Wow, what an honor and pleasure it is for us to be here, my wife and I. We feel like we are at home every time we come here. We're no stranger to this place. We've been here several times, and we're just honored and thrilled. I believe today is a day of destiny, an appointment with God for many people. How many people believe that? Before we start, I want to just introduce my wonderful bride of 35 years, Cynthia. Would you stand up? She's my best friend, my partner in life, the mother of my children, the grandmother to... Sorry. I shouldn't have said that because she looks too young. But, you know, I heard one day the best thing about... the worst thing about being a grandfather is that one day you wake up and you're sleeping next to a grandmother. I don't know where that comes from. You know, you never know what comes out under the anointing. But thank you so much for having us today. What an honor and pleasure it is for us to be here today on this very, very special day. And before we start, I want to say something that I have practiced for a while, and this is for Mama Bessie. Koronia pola, yati yorti tis mit teros. That means happy Mother's Day on this wonderful occasion. Some of you may have noticed Pastor Gus walked in. Praise God for that. Yes. That shows how much they love you. Shows how much I love you and you love me, because he only came at my request. I said, if you can, seriously, he wasn't going to be here today. Only came at my request because I believe God is going to do something here at the end of the service that is historical. Okay? So with that said, please, I want to ask you, honor him today. When we are done, he's going to skip out because he's in no condition to stand up, hug anybody, children running to him. So would you honor him with that today and allow him to rest one more week so he can come back strong next week? Yeah. Today, Mother's Day. We have traditionally honored mothers on this day, which we should. Is Roxanne out there? Roxanne, is she out there? There she is. Wonderful. I wanted to be here because she's my assistant, my personal assistant. I wanted her to be here because I want to honor her today also. Traditionally, on Mother's Day, we honor our mothers, and we should. Every day we should honor them. And I've never seen anything like this today, to honor mothers the way we did. It's wonderful, wonderful. But sometimes in our zeal to honor our mothers, there are women in the crowd that day that feel very left out. Mothers are supposed to be very happy. We honor our mothers. We are mothers, children honor us. But there are women in the crowd that have no fault of their own. They would want to come up here and receive a flower, but they couldn't. So I'm going to read something to you that I believe will pertain to every single woman in here. Will not leave anybody out. To those who gave birth this year to their first child, we'll celebrate with you. To those who lost a child this year, we mourn with you. To those who are in the trenches with little ones every day and wear the badge of food stains, we appreciate you. To those who experience loss through miscarriage, failed adoption, or running away, we hurt with you. To those who walk the hard path of infertility, fought the pokes, prods, tears, and disappointment. We walk with you. Please forgive us. When we say foolish things, we don't mean to make this harder than it is. To those who are foster moms, mentor moms, and spiritual moms, we need you. To those who have warm and close relationships with their children, we celebrate with you. To those who have disappointment, heartache, and distance, with your children, we sit with you. To those who lost mothers, we grieve with you. To those who experience abuse at the hands of your own mother, we acknowledge your experience and heartache. To those who live through driving tests, medical tests, and the overall testing of motherhood, we are better for having you in our midst. To those who are single and long to be married and mothering your own children, we grieve that life has not turned out the way you long for it to be. To those who step-parent, we walk with you on those complex paths. To those who envisioned lavishing love on grandchildren, yet this dream has not come to be, we hurt with you. To those who will have emptier nests in the upcoming year, we both grieve and rejoice with you. To those who place children up for adoption, we commend you for your selfless and remember how you hold that child in your heart. To those who are pregnant with new life, both expected and surprising, we anticipate with you. This Mother's Day, we walk with you. We honor you. Mothering is not for the faint of heart. And we have real warriors in our midst today. We remember you, we need you, we love you, and we honor you. Every woman that falls under any of those categories that I mentioned, would you stand to your feet right now? Every woman that falls under any of those categories, that should be all of you. One of you fall under that. We honor every single one of you. And we thank God for you. God bless you. Please forgive me for getting a little emotional because I'm that kind of guy. Father, we pray right now that you would come. Holy Spirit, come. Take over this service. We know that today we have a date with you, Lord. Today was on your calendar, on the foundation of the world. It wasn't on mine, it wasn't on Pastor Gus's, but it was on yours. Because today you wanted this something, whatever's going to happen here today, God, to take place. And I pray the Holy Spirit would come right now and take over this service, that truly you would give a breakthrough to every single person through the power of your Holy Spirit. A breakthrough, God, in every area of their life, and we know that's only possible through the power of your Holy Spirit. So come now, in Jesus' name. Today, I believe we have a day of breakthrough. How many believe that? In many, many different ways. The word breakthrough means removal of barriers, going to another level. I believe that it pleases God when we go to another level. And we remove the barriers to allow him, because a lot of those times we put the barriers up ourselves. And it doesn't allow us to go to another level. So today, if you remove the barriers, God wants to take you to another level. We have been in a very, very special season the past few weeks. I didn't know you guys are going through 31-day fast. When I heard that, I said, God, I know this is from you. By the way, thank you for showering me with all these rose petals. I'm not worthy. I'm only used to this at the house. My wife does it for me, but We are in a very powerful season. We just came off of one of the most powerful seasons of the year. Easter, resurrection. Before that, it was the Good Friday. It was a week of passion. The word passion, the root word of that means suffering. That means when someone has so much passion for something, he's willing to suffer for the cause. Jesus had so much passion that he was willing to suffer for the prize that was set before him. Because he knew Friday wasn't the end. Friday was the beginning. Because Sunday came. Opened up a door for Sunday. And when Sunday came, it opened up a huge gate for Pentecost. Because he was coming. Also, this past season, the week of 15th through 22nd, it was also Passover week. They overlapped. Is it by accident that they overlapped? I don't believe so, because everything with God on his calendar is perfect timing, even down to the date. God is never late, but let me tell you, he's never early either. We want him to be early, but he's not. In Exodus 23, Lord commanded his people. He said, 3 times a year, I want you to keep a feast or a festival for me. Early in spring, early summer, and early fall. Passover or unleavened bread, which we just had. Pentecost is coming. And tabernacle in the fall. The word feast in Hebrew is the word moed, which means appointed, favored time. We are in the middle of it right now, between the first feast and the second feast. Passover, Pentecost. June 8th, Pentecost, is a Pentecost Sunday. We are right in the middle of it. Do you think it's an accident that you happen to have your surgery? That you happen to call me? That I happen to be here? Nothing is an accident with God, because he wants to do something. He said, 3 times a year, I will make an appointment with you. Because I want to favor you. Because these are favorite season, favorite times of the year. I know what I'm talking about, because last year we started recognizing these favorite times. Miracle after miracle after miracle start happening. Not only in our lives, but everybody who believed. And there's a man sitting right there believing in it. He's the one that actually brought me his offering. He said, this is my Passover offering. I said, what is that? And he started explaining to me the church he came from. I said, okay, I'm going to study this. And what I have seen, miracle after miracle. So we said, this year, between these two seasons, we're going to declare season of miracle for people. And it is happening, folks. It is happening. Can you imagine God having an appointment with you? And you're not realizing it or missing it? Wow. Because he shows up. Are you going to show up? Are you going to recognize it? Some of you may say, oh, well, why do I need to keep... Why do I need to keep? This is Old Testament stuff. Well, Colossians 2, 16 and 17 says, let no one judge you in food or drink or regarding a festival or new moon or Sabbath, which are shadow of things to come, but the substance is of Christ. Favored appointed times. We just had also the four blood moons. There's been a lot of talk about that. I'm going to get into that today. You can go study that for yourself. But every time we've had the four blood moons, and it hasn't been that often, something amazing has happened. And it's all been related to Israel. First time it happened. Not the first time, but the last 3 times that it's happened. First time that we can remember in the history to go back was 1492, when all the Jews that were in Spain were deported from there. Then in 1948, when Israel became a nation. Then in 1967, when they recaptured Jerusalem. This season that we just had, 2014 and 2015, are the next four blood moons that are going to happen. Between this time and next year, watch for God's favor. Watch for God's blessing. Watch for God to start talking to you through what he wants to do. Everything is mentioned in Joel 2 and in Acts chapter 2. The last words that someone speaks is very, very important. Do you believe that? And he said in Joel 2 and in Acts 2, he said, I will talk to you through the stars, through the moons, through the signs in the sky. I will talk to you about the things that are going to come, the things that are happening. Then it says in Revelation, let those who have ears hear what the Spirit says to them. The last words of a person are very, very, very important. If I ask you today, what is the last words of Jesus? Most people would say, of course, it's Matthew 28. Going to all the world, make disciples, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Those were not his exact last words, the very last words. Those were the words that he spoke during the 40 days. We are in the middle of that 40 days right now. Okay? This happened 2,000 years ago. It was during that 40 days when he showed up himself. And it says in the book of Acts, he showed himself with infallible proofs that he was who he said he was. Okay? This is before he ascended. Acts 1:3. It says, to whom he also presented himself after his suffering with many infallible proofs, being seen by them during the 40 days, speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Then Acts 1:4-7, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know times or season which the Father has put in his own authority. And the next verse was his very last words. Verse 8, it says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and in Samaria and the end of the earth. How do I know it was his very last words? Because the next verse says, now when he had spoken these things, while they watched, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. He said, go there and wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit. Good Friday was the door that opened up for Resurrection Sunday. But he said, there's a gate that's going to come open. That's Pentecost. He said, I want you to go there and wait. So I want to talk to you about the promise of the Holy Spirit that Jesus talked about. The way that most people think and talk about the Holy Spirit is this way. They use words like initial evidence, historical, traditional pattern of Pentecost, and always they tie it to tongues only. When we say initial evidence, we're saying that we can judge somebody based on that evidence. I don't like to use that word evidence, because now we are the judge whether that person is baptized in the Holy Spirit or not, based on whether they can speak in tongues or not. Folks, there is a greater evidence that we should look for. That's a changed life. And that's what God wants for us, as an evidence. Let's use initial introduction experience. Wouldn't that be a better? Because if you, all you're doing is speaking in tongues and there's no changed life, what good was it? Okay? There needs to be a fruit. And when you have a changed life, that changed life can be discerned and it can be judged by others. So if you're going to judge something, judge them based on their fruit. You want to judge this house, look around you. Here's the fruit. Right here. When you come into total experience with the Holy Spirit, the real change starts. In Acts 4:13, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and they perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled, they wondered, and they realized the only explanation is that they had to have been with Jesus. That's the only explanation. Because they weren't judging them whether they were speaking in tongues or not. They were judging. There was a changed life that occurred so fast, they knew something had happened. And it had to be Jesus. People have made the Holy Spirit too complicated. They've made him mystical or strange. Therefore, much is not said or taught about the Holy Spirit in our churches today. I tell you what, we preach at a lot of different churches. There's a lot of churches that don't even mention the Holy Spirit. Mostly big churches. But let me tell you, the little ones that God is doing, the fires that are happening, they're so hungry for the Holy Spirit. They say, give me, give me, give me, give me. I want it, I want it, I want it. So I might mess with some of your theologies about what you have heard about the Holy Spirit. But that's okay. If that happens, I've done my job today. See, people mistakenly think that being filled with the Spirit is the same as being baptized. It's not. That's right there. I messed up with some of your theology. See, filled is the initial experience at salvation. So that's being filled versus baptized. I can go to the next one. That's the first one. When you first get introduced with the Holy Spirit, it's like dipping. When you get saved, you get the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He comes in you. All the Holy Spirit comes in you. You just get a taste of the Holy Spirit. You get a portion of His Spirit. That word is word bapto, which means dipping. When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit, that word baptismo means completely being overtaken, overflow completely by the Holy Spirit. I messed up here. Do I need to go to the next one? The root word of that is being pickled. Pickled. For something to become pickled, it needs to remain in the substance. That's when you put a cucumber in the substance or juice. After a while, it becomes pickle. Totally different properties, completely different taste, completely different subject. So when you get baptized, it's not just dipping. It's remaining in the Holy Spirit completely. That's when the change occurs. When you get filled, it's infilling. When you get baptized, it's the outflow. When you get filled, you get filled. When you get saved. When you get baptized, Holy Spirit gets spilled. There's a big difference. When you get saved, filled, you get the Spirit. When you get baptized, the Spirit gets you. When you get filled, you breathe in and you drink in. When you get baptized, you breathe out and you pour yourself out as a drink offering on others. When you get filled, it's all about me. When you get baptized, it's about others. That's a huge difference. Three questions that I ask about everything in life. When I learned this concept, I asked these three questions about every single thing. Why, what, and how? Why? Because if I know the why, if I'm sold on the why, I will figure out the what and the how. But I don't want to know about the what and the how if I don't know why I need to do what you're asking me to do. So why is the most important question. So let's start with that. Why? Because it was Jesus' intention, desire for every believer to receive the power of the Holy Spirit. Remember Acts 1:4, he said, go there and wait. Why did he say that? John 16:7, it says, it's better for you. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it's better. It's to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper would not come. But if I depart, I will send him to you. You know, sometimes we need things amplified for us. I don't know about you, but sometimes I read something, I'm like, I don't quite understand it. Can you amplify that? So I'm going to read the next verse to you out of the amplified version. John 16, to answer your why question. John 16, 13 through 15. But when the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, the truth-giving Spirit comes, He will guide you into all the truth, the whole truth. For He will not speak His own message on His own authority, but He will tell you what he hears from the Father, he will give the message that has been given to him, and he will announce, declare to you the things that are to come, that will happen in the future. He will honor and glorify me because he will take, receive, draw upon what is mine and will reveal, declare, disclose, transmit it to you. Everything that the Father has is mine. That is what I meant when I said that he, the Spirit, will take the things that are mine and will reveal, declare, disclose, transmit it to you. That's pretty clear, isn't it? Why we need the Holy Spirit. Because if you want to know, because they ask him, are you going to tell us now about the future, the kingdom of God? He said, it's not for you to know the time or the season. It's for my Father. But here it says, my Holy Spirit will reveal those things to you. So if you have that connection with the Holy Spirit, you don't have to walk around wondering what's going to happen in the future. You don't have to walk around wondering what the problem is, what is happening when things around the world start going bad. That is why we need him. Now what? The presence of God, the active presence of God, is what the Bible refers to as the Holy Spirit. That's what. At the Pentecost, they became aware of God's presence as he came down and he rested on them and revealed to himself. He became very real to them. See, Paul had a firsthand experience with the Holy Spirit on the road to Damascus when he got blinded. And he spent 3 days with the Holy Spirit alone. After that, he changed from Saul to Paul. He was never the same. Acts 17:23, it says, for I was passing through and considering the objects of your worship. I even found an altar with the inscription to the unknown God. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, here I am to proclaim to you. Now, here's a guy who was Saul. He becomes Paul. And as he's traveling around, he sees this. He said, this unknown God that you're worshiping, I'm here to tell you about him. Why? Because I met him. See, Jews refer to God as the unknown God. Muslims refer to him as the unknowable God. Muslims believe there's no way you can get to know God. But Jesus said, I have come here to reveal the Father by my Holy Spirit to you. I want you to know God. And the way you're going to know God and his plans for your life and what he has is through the Holy Spirit. That's why he said, go and receive the Holy Spirit. Because without him, you're not going to be able to understand. See, the Holy Spirit is a person. He's a person. He's not a power. He's not an it. He's not the source. He's a person. He has feelings. He's my helper. He's my teacher. And he is my friend. And he loves me. Do you believe that? And he wants to reveal God to me. That's why he came. He wants to reveal God to me. See, Jesus has two primary ministries. His introductory ministry was as a savior. It says he came to seek and save that which was lost. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. But his second ministry is his empowering ministry. After he comes and introduces you to the Father, the second part is empowering ministry, and that is he's known as the baptizer in the Holy Spirit. Luke 3:16 says, John answered, saying to all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal straps I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Introducing you now to and giving you access to the supernatural realm. That's why we need the Holy Spirit. The second part is not really an option for a victorious Christian living. It's not required. You don't have to be baptized with the Holy Spirit to go to heaven, no. But if you want to live a Christian life that is victorious, you're going to need the power of the Holy Spirit. People ask me, do I have to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Or do I have to speak in tongues? No, you don't have to. You get to. You don't have to. It's a bonus. It's a privilege. You get to speak in tongues. You get to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. You don't want it. Don't take it. You know, I just saw on here, you're going to have communion here. Let me tell you about communion. Next time you take communion, remember this. Jesus never told us how often to take communion. He said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. What happened on the night before he went to be betrayed, as he was sitting with his disciples, they took what we call Last Supper or Passover dinner. They had done this many, many times. But that night he did something different because he was trying to establish something new. He said, up to this point, you are remembering this Passover. You're celebrating it for what happened at Passover when 1,500 years earlier, when the angel of death came, and when you put the blood on the doorpost of your houses, he passed by. But he said, tonight I'm establishing something new. He said, now I'm going to become the Passover lamb. It's going to be my blood. It's not going to be the blood of the animals anymore. It's going to be my blood. It's going to be my blood applied to the doorpost of your heart, not the blood of the animals anymore. The night that he did that, this is to show you how precise God is about timing, even down to the date, was the 14th day of the month of Nisan, which was the night of Passover. Do you know that it was exactly to the date, the same date, 1,500 years earlier when the first Passover took place? Jesus was declaring, now it's complete. He said, I didn't come to abolish the law. I have come to fulfill it. He fulfilled that night. Talk about having an appointment with God. The disciples had an appointment with God that night. And every time you take communion, you have an appointment with God. Because God says, now I'm going to reveal to you something. I want to do something new in you. It's not about any of that. It's about remembering what I have done for you, folks. Sometimes we remember what happened in the past. Sometimes we have to remember the future. You ever had your kids reminding you, Dad, remember you told me you're going to buy me ice cream? They're reminding you. You made a promise. Jesus was saying, listen, that word that he used, remembrance, is the word anamnesis, which means not only remembering the past, which also means bringing into the present moment, and then also remembering in the future. He says, remember my future promise to you. Every time you take communion, you're thanking God for what he did in the past, what he's doing right there in the moment, but also thanking for the promise that he said, I'm going to do something for you in the future. Luke 22:15, then Jesus said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover meal with you before I suffer. He said, I've been looking for this. This was a date. I had a date. This is not an accident. I've been looking for this night. Luke 22:18 says, for I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of this vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he was saying, listen, this is the last meal we're going to take together. The next meal we'll have together, it was going to be in the marriage supper of the Lamb in heaven. He said, between now and then, I want you, when you take this meal, remember me, what I've done for you, what I'm going to do for you. He said, don't forget, don't get so caught up in the things of the world that you're going to forget. Now, we talked about the why and the what, how. Acts 19 talks about it. Paul asked Ephesians 19:2. He said, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? So they said to him, we have not even heard so much that there is a Holy Spirit. And he goes, what happened then? Who were you? What were you baptized? He said, I was baptized in the baptism of John. He said, oh, that was the baptism of repentance. But he said, the baptism, the real baptism, I'm talking baptism of fire, is baptism of the Holy Spirit. Then he said, he laid hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. Folks, there's been too much made out of this Holy Spirit and the baptism and speaking in tongues. That's why people keep the Holy Spirit at a arm's length. First is the repentance, baptism of repentance. Then comes the second, the baptism of empowerment. There's no waiting involved. The only time that there is waiting was on the day of Pentecost, folks. You can receive baptism of the Holy Spirit today. If you know Christ as your Lord and Savior, that's the only prerequisite. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. Now, I want to talk to you today. There are five faces of Pentecost. Five faces. And every church falls under one of these categories. First one is the retro Pentecost. They're stuck in the past. They're stuck in the past. They're traditional with their Christianese tone and their language. They use words like tarry, oh, let's tarry for the Holy Spirit. Folks, we need to use today's modern words. Why can't we just say wait? When I was a young Christian, and people were trying to tell me about baptism of the Holy Spirit, they say, well, we're going to tarry on the Holy Spirit. And I'm thinking, who's Terry? I was literally waiting for this guy named Terry to walk in. I'm like, when is Terry going to show up? Come on. I didn't know what Terry meant. If they had said, let's wait for the Holy Spirit, I'd go, oh, okay. That's retro. Then we have prosperity. That's what you see on TV. Enough said about that. Then you have the hyper. It's loud, they shout, they're emotional. They tell you if you give this much, this is what's going to happen, and there is no fruit. Why? Because they're preying on your emotion, and at the moment, they think by shouting and spitting or whatever, by your emotions, that they got you. But when you leave, they go, you go, what was that? Because there's no changed life. Then you have nominal. Nominal. This is where most of the churches are. Handle with care. Handle the Holy Spirit with caution. We love the Holy Spirit. Oh, we respect Him. We need the Holy Spirit. But let's not bring Him up too often. Because every time we bring Him up, it disrupts our services and it disrupts my comfort. And I'm worried He's going to come over and take over. So Holy Spirit, can you please just stand over there? Don't come too close. Because every time you come over here, I lose control. And I got to let you do everything. Therefore, nominal. Then finally, we have the authentic. It doesn't focus only on tongues and manifestation. It naturally and freely and orderly integrates the supernatural into the whole body of biblical truths and practices. Folks, if it's not authentic, we don't want it. And if there's no fruit being produced, we don't want it. We have the authentic Pentecost happening at this church. I've seen it for years. I have seen it for years. I remember when you were down in that little house, the first time I preached for you, when I couldn't even breathe. There was so many people in there. I'm like, man, you need a bigger place. What are we going to do? People wanted to fall down. They couldn't fall because there was no place to fall. Next time I came, you had something here. The next time I came, you blew this wall out. Next time I came, you blew that wall out. Next time I came, you bought every... Why? This is real, folks. What's happening here? Because there's fruit. John 7:38, again, the Amplified Version says, he who believes in me, who cleaves to and trusts and relies on me, as the scripture has said, from his innermost being will flow continuously springs of living water. Who relies on me, who cleaves to me. Your pastor relies on the Holy Spirit. He cleaves to the Holy Spirit. He knows it's not him doing it. Because we talked about this. I know it's not me. It's the Holy Spirit. And all he says, I'm willing, Holy Spirit. Will you use me? I trust you to empower me. I hold on to you, Holy Spirit. That's why God is using this house. Because the Holy Spirit is welcome. The Holy Spirit is being manifested in the lives of people. And he said, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. Three dimensions of the flow of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit flows, it flows first upwards to God in prayer and worship and praise. Then it flows outwards to people in evangelism, in teaching and preaching and service. What you have here, what you go outreaches, all the stuff that you do is flowing out from here towards people. Then after it goes upwards and outward and inward is the final part, which is to us for edification and building ourselves up. Jude 20 says, build yourself up in the Holy Ghost. Authentic Pentecost is not stuck in the past, or hyper, or focus only on tongues, or prosperity. It is not nominal. It uses today's methods and is relevant language. People ask, do I have to be Pentecostal to speak in tongues? Huh? Was Jesus Pentecostal? Or was John the Baptist Baptist? I don't know. If Jesus was talking to us today and teaching, he would use today's words. He wouldn't be using words like mustard seed. Because right now you say, bring me some mustard seed. Most of you have never seen mustard seed. You don't even know what it is. He used that word mustard seed because back then the farmers could understand. They were farmers. They knew he meant something small. If he was going to talk today to you in today's language, he said, if you have faith as small as a microchip or a fuse. We all understand what a microchip is, even though most of us never seen a microchip either. But we know what a microchip is or a fuse is. He wouldn't say Terry. He would say wait. So there's a couple of words that scare people and cause them to hold baptism of the Holy Spirit at arm's length. The first word is Pentecost. When you mention Pentecost or Pentecostals, people start to go, whoa, where did they go? What they see in their mind is people jumping up and down, shouting, praising, screaming, falling down, or sometimes they before I even got baptized, they're talking about people handling snakes and stuff. Those are the things we see. So therefore they go, they think Pentecost. When they use that word Pentecost, they relate it to that. But let me tell you, the word Pentecost simply means 50. Pentecosti means 5 times 10, which means 50 days after the resurrection. There's nothing scary about the word 50, is there? Is there? If I shouted 50, that didn't scare you, did it? No, neither should Pentecost. It just means 50. 50 days after the resurrection, by the way, we are in the middle of it right now. That's what's exciting about the season that you're in, brother. We are in the middle of that right now. Then the other word is the word spirit or ghost. Let me tell you about that. That word in Greek is the word pneuma, which we get our words like pneumatic tools, power tools. That word pneuma means breath or air. In Hebrew is the word ruah. Again, means the same thing, breath or air. I want to put your hand over your mouth right now and just say a few words. Do you feel that vibration? That's breath, okay? That's breath, that's ruah, that's pneuma. That's the same thing, it's a breath. The letter H in Hebrew stands for the word ruach. When God wants to show people something that is far beyond their understanding, he has to get them past their understanding, the natural man, and takes them into a supernatural realm so they can see what he sees. See, he says, my spirit will reveal to you what are the things to come. He did this with Abraham. He did this with Adam. When Adam was nothing, dust of the earth, after he made him, created him, he took him and he breathed into his nostrils, and the life went into him and he became alive. He did this with Abraham. Abraham's name was Abram. Before he became Abraham, he put him to sleep, and he came and he went to Abraham. When he got up, he went from Abram to Abraham. He just breathed on him. Then he said, now Abraham, can you see? Can you see the stars? Can you see the mountain? Can you see what I got for you? Because as Abram, he wasn't able to see that. But once he became Abraham, he could see it. He said, all of these is what's going to be yours. Then he did the same thing to Sarah. His name was Sarai. You know how many times when a wife or a husband gets saved and the other one doesn't, causes a problem. Especially when they get filled with the Holy Spirit and the other one is not. It always brings division. So God knew he had to take Sarai, okay, and he made him Sarah. He took the I out and put his breath in, Sarah. So now, together, they could accomplish what God had for them. Acts 2, verses 1 through 6. I'm going to read this to you first out of the New King James Version. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. As they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, and they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in their own language. Now, I want to read this to you. If Jesus was talking today, and he was talking in today, I'm going to read it to you in today's language so you can understand that. Let's read this now in today's language. 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus, the 120 were all together waiting for the promise from the Lord. And suddenly, they heard a sound which resembled a powerful wind, and it came to fill the whole house. Then they saw what happened to be a fire on top of each other's head, and they were all filled with the breath of God as he breathed on them, and they spoke in each other's language, and they were astonished. There's nothing confusing or scary about any of that, is there? All says what happened on that day. God came and he breathed on them. He said, the promise that I told you 50 days before, this is it. This is what happened. That's all it is. People thought that they were drunk. And Peter said, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. He said, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Folks, what happened on the day of Pentecost was the blessed reversal of the curse of Babel. Go home, read chapter 11 of Genesis. This is what happened in Genesis chapter 11. They were all together. They were united. And they wanted to be like God. So they said, we're going to build this tower now. We're going to reach up right into the heaven. And God looked down and he said, these people are united. They're so united that nothing would be withheld from them. So he came down and he confused their language and he scattered them. Look the difference between that. The attitude was proud, arrogant. They were united. They had one pure language. And God came and he scattered them and confused them with many languages. Look what happened on the day of Pentecost. They came from scattered places. They were confused. But their attitude was one of humility and obedience, waiting on God. And they were united again in one pure language, which is language of the Spirit. What was lost in the book of Genesis, God restored. God restored. You know, there's another benefit of receiving the power of the Holy Spirit. Not only you get a changed life, not only you get to hear God, your whole focus in life changes. Why? Because, like I said, it goes from me to others. Somewhere in life, every person comes to this conclusion, why was I born? What's the purpose of my life? Dita, was I born to just get rich? Was I born to accumulate stuff? Because I'm telling you, there's a lot of people here in Phoenix, in Paradise Valley, they live in golden prisons. They live in prisons. They had just so happened the bars are made out of gold. They're asking the same question. Why was I born? Why did I accumulate all this? What is it for? When you get baptized in the Holy Spirit and you start hearing his voice, he'll start telling you life is not about you, it's about others. And in that process comes the fulfillment of life. In that process comes the fulfillment of life. I'm going to turn this one on now because I need both hands. You'll hear me. Yes? Yes? One thing that happens. No. Can I hear me? Yes?
No.
Okay, I need both hands, so I'm going to do something tricky here. Hello, there we go. There's always more than one way to skin a cat. When life gives you a lemon, you make lemonade. The greatest thing that happens is when you become a different person. God will give you a vision. You go ahead and put the vision down. Walk away from it. You put the vision down, but the vision will not let you down. Will come and pick you up and say, pick me up. You say, no, this is too hard. Dude, I'm spending my life. I'm spent. I can't do this anymore. I got to walk away. And you come out here in this world where you're not supposed to be. God says, no, go back. Go back over there. Even though this is where it was a place of uncomfort, discomfort, and pain, anguish. You were accomplishing my purposes here. I have greater purposes. Nobody ever said Christian life was going to be easy or comfortable. But it's fulfilling. It's fruitful. Every time you try to put the vision down, the vision picks you up and says, come. It calls you. Gus, pick me up, man. Saeed, pick me up. Jim, Joe, Judy, pick me up. I brought you here for a reason. You start to walk away, go towards the world. You realize the world has nothing to offer to me. I've been there. It is nothing but death. I got to come back. I got to come back to the Word of God. I got to come back to what God has for me. Folks, the perfect example of that was a guy named Jeremiah. You heard of him in the Bible? Jeremiah chapter 20. God, this was a young preacher. God gave him a huge mission. He was supposed to go and rebuke these people, higher ups. Imagine God telling me, you need to go in front of the general council of Assembly of God, people that ordained you, and tell them, straighten up or God's going to smite you. Well, who am I? But nevertheless, God told Jeremiah, he had a big plan for Jeremiah, a big project. So Jeremiah in chapter 20, verse 9, it says, God, I've decided, I'm paraphrasing it for you, I've decided to not bring you up anymore. Because every time I bring your word up, it causes problems, it becomes anguish, and I get in trouble. But he said, every time I try to put the word down, the word picked me back up. Why? Because he said, it was as though there was a fire shooting out of my bones. He said, your word was a fire. Your word was a fire that shot out of my bones. He said, every time I put it down, it picked me back up. Every time I try to put it out, it picked me back up. Every time I walk away, it picked me back up. Because why? Because there was a fire that shot out of my bones. I couldn't do it. Folks, let me tell you the story about this. This is not just an ordinary thing. 2 years ago, October, one of my mentors, great dear friends, Pastor Leo Godzich. I went to Uganda with him, changed my life, known him for 15 years. Just a wonderful, wonderful man. Learned so much from him. He was going to Uganda, and the day before he went, he came to my office, and we would pray together, we would speak in tongues, we would pray for hours. We were prayer partners. We understood each other. The only two people on staff that would get together pray in tongues. We were like this. He comes to my office for praying. At that time, the following week, my wife was doing a presentation called Carriers of the Flame, which was the presentation of the Ephesians chapter 6, the whole armor of God, where we had all these soldiers would come out, and she did a beautiful teaching on the whole armor of God, and at the end I'll come out with the whole chainmail and all that, and he goes, wow, you need to use my fire Bible. I go, what is that? He said, let me go get it. So he goes home and gets his fire Bible and brings it to me. He said, you need to use that. I go, wow, this is amazing. How long can I use that? Keep it till I come back. Well, that's not the end of the story. The story, I wish it was the end of the story, but it's not, because he never came back. While he was preaching in Uganda, when he was traveling from Uganda to Kenya, he was passing a car. The car was passing another car, and he got sandwiched between two trucks. Five pastors instantly perished. He was my age. Never came back. Wow. As I was praying about it, keep it till I come back. The Lord said, listen, he was talking to you prophetically. Keep the fire going. He entrusted you with the fire. He entrusted you with fire. So therefore, everywhere I go, we go to preach. I take this with me. If I fly, if I, we travel someplace else, I send it ahead of time that is waiting for me when I go there, and I do the demonstration at the end. Lately, last year, the Lord said, now I want you to go take it another step. I want you to get some of these. You know how long it took? Trust me, go Google Fire Bible, you never find it. I'm not going to tell you how to find it either, because that's my secret. Anyway, we found it. The Lord said, I want you to get some of that, and I want you to do something to certain churches that you go to. Pastor Gus, would you come up here? John, can you get this picture, photo? Photo. You need the picture. I have done this, we've done this in three places. The Lord said there's going to be places where I'm going to speak to you. Strategic places where I'm getting ready to do something, take them to the next level. I want you to take one of these for them and present it to them. And he said, what I want you to do is, the fire that started here, open yours. I want you to pass that fire to them so they can keep the flame going. And the scripture that I wrote in here for him, the only way you can put that fire out is to do it on purpose. And we're doing this on purpose right now. Because technically, I'll give you the instructions for later. You're not supposed to do it for...
Thank you.
The scripture says to my brother Gus, keep the fire burning. Much love, Saeed and Cynthia. Psalms 104:4. He says, I will make my ministers a flame of fire. And you already are a flame of fire. So right now, we want to seal that anointing. There's a reason why God had him rest this week. Your pastor has been working very hard, too hard. The Bible says, he makes me lay down on the green pastures. He made you lay down because he wants you to regroup for what he asked for you next. There is greater anointing coming. There's greater power coming. There's greater blessing coming. This was by no accident that God had planned for today. So stretch your hands out towards your pastor. Father, in the name of Jesus, fresh anointing today, God. David got anointed 3 times, Lord. This is a fresh anointing for a fresh new season, God. As he goes home and he rests, restore his strength. Restore his youth. Restore his power. Renew everything. Let this be just a season of renewal, refreshment, restructure. Whatever you're doing, God, something new. Let him hear from heaven. Like never before. Let him see with his eyes, through the eyes of the Holy Spirit, God. Let him feel with his heart like never before. We anoint these hands, God, to be a blessed hands. The fresh anointing. That he will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. That there will be a fresh power coming upon them today from on high. This is the next level, God. This is another level. So many more levels you have for this man and this church, God. And today is that new level, God. Father, put a new hedge of protection around him. Put a hedge of protection around him, around his family, around his staff. I want all the staff members to come around him right now. All the staff members. If you're a staff of this church, come on up here. Come on up here. Family members, staff, those of you are surrounding him. Come on up here. Surround him. We want to just pray a fresh anointing, a fresh blessing, a fresh power over him. Father, we pray for the entire staff, every single one of them. And as this man goes to another level, you would take them to another level. You would show them new visions, new dreams, new songs from heaven, God, new worship, new instruction from heaven, new touch from heaven, fresh anointing, God. Bless them for all their work and their support of this man and this ministry, God. A fresh blessing, a fresh anointing, God. And we just thank you for the fathers and the mothers, God, that have gone before, that have paved the way for this young man, that they've held him up, oh God. We pray for them. We anoint them with a fresh anointing this day, God. And for all the spiritual mothers that are in this place today, on this Mother's Day, God, that they will surround this man like never before. They will love on him like never before. That today every person will leave here different than when they came. With a new zeal, with a new touch, with a new power, God. We surround him, God, here in the natural. And we pray your Holy Ghost, your holy angels will surround each and every one of them and surround this entire congregation, will surround this entire campus. That, Lord, you let the multiplication anointing start happening. Habakkuk 1:5. I'm getting ready to do something in your days, the Lord says. That if I told you right now, you would not believe me. That's what God has for you. You would not believe me if he told you right now. Because it's far greater. And you're going to need a greater strength through the power of the Holy Spirit. Take the limits off. Take the limits off of yourself and off of God. Because there's greater things that he wants to do. Your eye has not seen, your ears not heard, neither has it entered your heart. Those things that God has prepared for you and this house. And the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former. Amen. The best days of your life, the best days of your ministry, the best days of this ministry and this church are still ahead. So Father, fill them with your strength right now. We thank you. And we praise you in Jesus' name. Give God glory.
Thank you. I receive that.
Now, I don't want to miss the Holy Spirit, but those who came here today have not received the power, the initial experience of receiving the Holy Spirit. We're not going to drag this out because we've gone over. Stand to your feet. I'm just going to pray for you from right here. All you got to do is believe. All you got to do is believe. The only prerequisite is know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Because I don't know all of you, we're going to take care of that real quick. Just say this quickly. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. Thank you for dying for me and giving me access to your Holy Spirit. Help me to live for you. In Jesus' name. Quick and simple. You already met the prerequisite. God wants to give, that is a gift that God wants to give to you. A gift is only a gift. But when you receive it, it becomes your gift. You met the prerequisite. The next thing is that you must believe it's for you. Do you believe it's for you? Obviously, because you stood to your feet. The next thing is that you must desire the gift. Do you desire the gift? Obviously, because you stood up to your feet. The next thing is that you must ask for it with your own mouth. The final thing is that you must do the speaking. God is not going to move your mouth for you. So right now, just start with your own understanding. Say, baptize me with your Holy Spirit. Give me the initial experience with your Holy Spirit. Let me meet your Holy Spirit fully, completely. The Bible says, out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. That living water he was talking about is the Holy Spirit. That the day you got saved went in you. 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, we have this treasure in this earthen vessel that the excellency and the power may be of God and not of ours. The treasure he was talking about, the day you got saved, God deposited a treasure inside you, which is his Holy Spirit. When you get baptized, you start speaking in tongues. When it comes out of you, flow out of you, it gives you the ability to tap into that treasure. God wants to give you the ability to tap into that treasure. Right now, all you have to do is by faith, open your mouth, start speaking. I'm not going to tell you what to say. The Holy Spirit will give you the utterance. By just something is resonating inside you. Start repeating out loud. Why is it important to say it out loud? Because when you say it out loud, three things happen. God hears it. And he says, wow, they finally believe me. Now I can start talking to them that will hear me. The devil hears it also. And he says, wow, I lost another one because now they're going to go around praying in tongues and I won't be able to understand them. Then when you speak it out loud, it goes right back in your ear and you hear it and you believe it that it's actually happened. So right now, start speaking. Something is resonating around you, inside you. Just say it out by faith. It doesn't make any sense to your mind. Bypass the mind. Let it go straight to your heart, from your heart down to your spirit. Start speaking. Those of you around you who already have it, start speaking. It'll encourage the rest of them. God wants to reveal himself to you through his Holy Spirit. It's a promise. You have been waiting long enough. He wants to give you a breakthrough in your life. He wants to break through in your emotions, in your finances, in your family. Everything. Today is a day of breakthrough. Don't leave the same way that you came by allowing your mind to stop what God wants to do in your spirit. It makes no sense to your mind right now. The understanding will come later. By faith, open your mouth. You will never be the same. You will never be the same. You will never be the same. Father, I pray you see those who got up. You see the desire. God, they desire more of you. They desire your Holy Spirit. I pray, Lord, that you would fill them. You would baptize them to overflowing, God. That there would be such a presence of God upon them that they would not be able to stop being in your presence. That you would put a new insatiable hunger and desire in them for you and for your glory, God. Go with them today. Go with them as they leave today, God. Let them know that they had an appointment with you today and you met them here and you blessed them and you want to continue to use them, guide them, direct them in every aspect of their life. And everybody who agreed said a big amen. God bless you. Thank you for having me here today. Okay, we're dismissed. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.